would affect the growth momentum. There is indeed cause for concern. More than a year into President Rodrigo Duterte's term, political uncertainty grows. Most troubling is the deteriorating state of human rights. The spate of extrajudicial killings in relation to the president's war on drugs and martial law in Mindanao have raised the specter of strongman rule in the country. On the other hand, many of the erstwhile ruling party, and critics of the president are also hamstrung by their identification with laissez-faire oligarchic rule that has been associated with the restoration of electoral democracy since 1987. This growing polarization has given rise to a state of constant political agitation, while rumors of destabilization efforts circulate. The administration has intensified its attacks against government officials and business figures identified with the previous government. No doubt, the political uncertainty created by these trends has had some chilling effects on investments. In the short term, however, the impact has yet to translate into declining growth. Various reasons have been given for the economy's resilience. One is a time lag before the economy shows the consequences of political decisions and actions. Another is the economic manager's relative autonomy in policy making. My presentation this morning will approach the question of the relationship between political developments and growth momentum by reversing the causal arrow. Okay, so I asked the question, how has the country's pattern of growth impacted politics? Here I will examine the basis of such growth and will argue that the dramatic growth of the Philippine economy for more than a decade now owes much to the booming international trade in services that has worked to free the economy from structural constraints that has held it back in the past. Specifically, the country's labor, export, and business process outsourcing industries, mainly servicing foreign markets, and the surge in private consumption supported by services export receipts have helped insulate the economy from the vagaries of Philippine politics. My presentation will have three parts. I begin by retracing the dramatic growth of services export industries in the country to the years 2004 and 2007, among the most turbulent periods in the country's political history. I will then discuss how the current growth models is changing the relationship between the economy and politics. This part briefly examines how rapid growth has impacted the middle class and the poor. Finally, I will conclude by suggesting the need for the grounding of the growth momentum in the real economy in order to strengthen the feedback mechanism between state and society. To begin, if we were to pinpoint the time when the Philippine economy began to take off, one would be surprised that we would have to go back to the years 2004-2007, a low point in recent history. Many in this room will recall that the country was then on the brink of deep fiscal crisis, largely due to a record national debt of 3.36 trillion pesos. During that period, then President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo was also struggling to get past allegations of having won the 2004 national elections through massive electoral fraud and was hounded by threats of military coups and impeachment proceedings. Yet 2 years after what was widely seen as a crisis of legitimacy, the country began its economic takeoff. In 2007, the Banco Central governor proudly announced that the country was enjoying a balance of payment surplus and was on track to grow an unprecedented 7%. The proximate reason for this stunning reversal of fortune was the imposition of the reformed value-added tax on oil and electricity in 2005, which immediately raised much-needed revenues for the cash-strapped government. Yet it was also during this period that government had begun to more seriously promote trade in services, notably labor export and the business process outsourcing, or BPO, industries. In the mid-2000s, government approach to overseas labor changed from seeing it as a temporary solution to unemployment and foreign currency shortfalls to locating it at the core of the national development program. To make this happen, the administration began to mobilize the whole bureaucracy, led by the Banco Central ng Pilipinas in charge of foreign currency flows, notably remittances, and the Department of Labor. In 2005, the Philippine Overseas Employment Authority, or POEA, further decentralized the recruitment services, its recruitment services, to reach provincial labor markets and forged government-to-government placement programs. And due to such efforts, the POEA was able to meet its target of deploying 1 million contract workers overseas. The impact of this massive deployment of overseas Filipino workers, or OFW, was dramatic. As per EOEA data, remittances increased by 25% in 2005. In 2006, OFW remittances surpassed official development aid and foreign direct investment combined. In 2007, remittances jumped up to $14.5 billion, contributing to a 6.3% increase in private consumption for that year. The dramatic increase in remittances over the past decade is matched only by the foreign exchange revenues earned by the country's business process outsourcing industries. In the early 2000s, in response to the booming global outsourcing industry and the lobby of domestic property developers, government began to provide incentives to promote the setting up of world-class information technology parks and buildings as special economic zones. This and the country's large English-speaking college-educated workforce began to attract BPO global players, drawing in foreign investment in unprecedented amounts, from $329 million in 2005 to $1.8 billion in 2008. The Philippine case that suggests that the service industries, which by nature are fragmented and are often less capital intensive than those in manufacturing, may thrive amidst political instability. This may in fact be more true in trade and services that largely relies on overseas earnings. One can even argue that based on the Philippines turnaround during the brief 2004-2007 period, international trade and services may boost the chances of a regime's survival without effecting structural reforms or even broad-based growth. In this light, there is a need to interrogate how the country's pattern of growth, which has become so much more tied to global markets through services, might change the relationship between the economy and politics. Two emerging trends come to mind. First, massive flow of services export receipts is changing the nature of the middle class and the main sources of wealth creation in the country. They're linking politics and economic development in the process. Democratization literature argues that with a rising middle class and a robust domestic business sector comes greater public demand for a more accountable, participatory and responsible government. The Philippines, which boasts of being the region's oldest democracy, seemed to conform to this view when, in 1986, middle-class-led street protests in combination with a military rebellion tipped the balance in favor of a 14-year anti-dictatorship struggle against the Marcos regime. Over the past decade, however, there's been a dramatic change in the nature of the middle class, whose expansion owes much to the booming trade in services. With more than 10 million Filipinos living and working permanently or temporarily abroad, and more than 1 million Filipinos working in the BPO industry, mainly servicing foreign clientele, the Philippine middle class has been characterized as being deterritorialized, in part because of its geographical dispersal and outward orientation, are politically weaker than its counterparts in Thailand, Malaysia, and Indonesia. In fact, increased mobility due to globalization allows labor to vote with its feet during periods of scarcity or uncertainty at home. At the same time, the current development pattern that largely draws on the dynamism from external markets has strengthened economic elites, whose business lie in the circulation of goods, capital, and labor. To capture the windfall gains from remittances, the Philippine conglomerates have gone into banking, through which billions of dollars in remittances are coursed, and in education, housing, healthcare, leisure, and retail to meet the demands of the OFW families. For its part, the rise of the BPO industry, which linked the country's skilled workforce to multinational service providers, has also opened new rental streams for property developers. In this connection, largely due to the diversifying commercial interests, the network of 9 of the country's wealthiest business families grew from $11 billion in 2006 to $43.4 billion in 2013. The flow of services export receipts has thus given Philippine business an alternative source of wealth creation that is less vulnerable to political disruption. Second, high growth, however, has had limited impact on poverty alleviation and the reduction of income inequality. To be sure, the number of those living below the poverty line and income inequality has decreased. According to the government figures, poverty incidence declined from 26.6% in 2006 to 21.6% in 2015. Yet despite sustaining a growth rate of 6% or more throughout the decade, more than 26 million Filipinos remain poor. And of this staggering number, 12 million Filipinos live in grinding poverty. Income inequality went down, but only slightly. Specifically, the Gini index went down from 0.46 in 2000 to 0.43 in 2012. According to a Brookings Institute study, the country's Gini index would in fact go as high as 0.60 if the missing data of the top 1% was taken into account. Another study on income distribution in the country noted that from 2009 to 2012, the poorest share of the income pie became smaller, while that of the upper classes grew bigger over the years. Okay, I just have to talk. More than two decades since the ouster of President Marcos, political democracy has yet to translate into more equitable development. Rather, what we see today is a deepening of a dual service economy where the most dynamic businesses are those that are fully integrated into the global markets, while the vast majority are micro enterprises, many of which belong to the informal sector. Indeed, since wealth creation relies less on agriculture and manufacturing, the growth momentum has failed to create dividends among the lower classes. What does this suggest in terms of the country's political trajectory? One, as the middle and the upper classes become deterritorialized, they also become less available politically for cross-class alliances that in other contexts have proven crucial for securing a more democratic and just society. Two, the almost glacial pace in which the benefits of the current pattern of growth trickle down to the lower classes also means that there is very little buy-in among the poor on the so-called EDSA state, named after the street where the broad democratic forces dealt the final blow to authoritarian rule in 1986. That is, a development model that has very limited linkages to the domestic economy, will also produce a class configuration with a diminished stake in domestic politics. A trend that could explain the difficulty today in forging a cross-class movement, similar to that which saw action more than 20 years ago. Instead, what we are seeing today is widening political polarization. To conclude, my talk suggests that it is that to understand what seems like a political stagnation all around, one needs to situate this trend in the development pattern that largely rests on services export receipts to ensure growth. No doubt labor export in the BPO industries have proved a boon to the economy that had trailed behind its neighbors. The work now is to deepen the service sector's link to domestic agriculture and manufacturing industries. This will not only help generate more productive and quality employment for those left behind by the so-called growth momentum. The development of a well-articulated economy could also contribute to restoring the feedback mechanism between the state and society, a link that would go a long way in promoting an accountable government and an engaged citizenry. Thanks.